Welcome back, Red Eyes members. Thank you very much for tuning in to our second segment with Georgia Lambert. We're having a very interesting conversation about esoteric traditions. We're talking about this from the perspective of some of the Western disciplines as well. And in this second segment, we're going to dive into a little bit more about the different techniques that Georgia has been studying. And I want to begin this on the note of something that Georgia brought up in the DVD series, The Great Work, that we mentioned briefly before we ended in the first segment. This was specifically about the third eye and about the pineal gland. I guess that this is the most common theory, as it were, in regards to what the third eye actually is. So you often hear that the pineal gland is the third eye. There has been some studies on this which shows that there are some components in the pineal gland that is similar to an eye. But Georgia, you had a different take on this, and maybe you can tell us a little bit about this. I think it's really, really interesting.
Yes. Well, most of the stuff that you find out on the marketplace about the third eye is limited, let's say, and also heavily veiled. If you read Eastern traditions, the third eye is often associated with the Ajna center, which is the energy center or chakra in front of the forehead. Other traditions relate it to the crown or head center, the thousand-petal lotus just above the physical head. Some relate it to the pineal gland because there is cellular structure within the pineal gland that does respond to light. One of the things that the pineal gland does, for instance, in salamanders and snakes, is that it's very close to the surface and it's responsive to sunlight and moonlight. And of course, within the human being, the pineal gland is responsive to a different kind of light, let's say, but it also regulates your body clocks, your biorhythms. However, in Eastern and Western tradition, they talk about the fact that every energy center, major and minor, or chakra if you like, has a physical touchdown point within the body. The Ajna center in front of the forehead has for its physical touchdown point the pituitary gland. Now, this is appropriate because the Ajna center in front of the forehead is sort of like the switchboard for all the centers below it. It's a point of integration. The symbol for this would be the charioteer in the chariot pulled by the three horses. This is your command center for your personality. And so the gland that is associated with it is the pituitary, which is a master controlling gland of bodily systems. The pineal gland is more obscure. In different esoteric traditions, the pineal gland has been depicted as a pomegranate. You see this on top of Masonic pillars a lot, or an apple, or a pine cone. You see in Greek tradition the pine cone on the staff of the initiatrix, the thyrsus. At certain initiations, only pine resin was burned as incense. In early America, the pineapple was a symbol, and you see the pineapple figuring prominently in colonial Masonic symbology. So all of these symbols relate to the pineal gland, which is kind of like a little pine cone in its shape, and it is the physical touchdown point for the head center or crown chakra or thousand petal lotus. The true third eye is not any of these things. The true third eye is not astral clairvoyance. And in the marketplace, you see this association. You know, people that can see auras or colors, they say they have an open third eye. This is not really what the true third eye is. The true third eye only comes into being at a very high stage of initiatory work. The internal work must have brought the Ajna center into activity, the center in front of the forehead. You have to have the head center above the head active, and the interaction of these two together produces a magnetic field within the head and creates really a new center altogether. And one of the functions of this new center is the function of the third eye. The symbol of the eye within the pyramid is actually the presence of the soul within the pyramid of centers within the head. If you consider the head center above the physical head, the ajna center at the forehead, and another center to the back and at the base of the skull, when all of these three centers have, through proper internal work and discipline, been brought into a state of activity, their magnetic auras overlap within the center of the head, and that creates the possibility of the eye in the pyramid. A pyramid means fire in the middle.
Yes.
In Celtic tradition, you have a lot of poetry that talks about the fire in the head. The Celts believed that the head was the seat of the soul. And so the true third eye, its function and its center only becomes possible at a certain stage of internal work when all three centers within the head have been brought into integration.
Interesting. And would you say even that the entire body is incorporated into this? Because again, if the pituitary gland is something that regulates other systems in the body, I guess that the whole body needs to be in line, so to speak, with this in order for us to come into this particular state. Or what would you say, Georgia?
Yes, absolutely. However, in the past, people have made the mistake of working from the outside in. And spiritual evolution doesn't work that way. It works from the inside out. In the East, they talk about the chakras or lotuses unfolding their petals. Things work from subtle to dense. In other words, initiation has to take place on higher, more subtle levels. And as it then is precipitated downward in frequency, it produces changes in the mind or the mental body or nature. That then continues and produces changes in the astral emotional nature. And finally, we see the physical manifestations of this. But the physical manifestations are the tail end of the process. The minute you start talking about physical processes, there's always somebody out there who thinks they can get holy by manipulating their glands. And it doesn't work that way. You're only asking for trouble. Because each chakra is threefold in its makeup. The very center point is that presence or point of spirit that we are at our very heart. In the East, they say, Om Mani Padme Hum, or hail to the jewel in the lotus. The jewel in the lotus is that point of spirit at its very center. Now, that point of spirit creates a magnetic field, which is its field of consciousness, its state of consciousness. The kind of consciousness that's expressed at the forehead center, for instance, is different than the kind of consciousness expressed at the solar plexus, the seat of the emotions. And then finally, you have the outer picture of that center. And most of the technologies that you see in the New Age market for, quote, manipulating your chakras, only affect the form of that chakra, not its consciousness, and certainly not its point of spirit, which means that you can maybe have a temporary outer effect, but until the consciousness changes, It's not permanent. It's a temporary fix. It's a Band-Aid. And the consciousness will eventually reassert its own frequency. So growth has to happen from the inside out, from subtle levels working toward the dense levels.
Well, that's interesting. I want to ask you then a little bit about some of the things that some people are into in regards to different devices, be it some times that they're electrical, there's some kind of external manipulation, if you want to use that word, on your body, on your systems, or even on your chakra points. Do you think that that's not a good thing to use? If we even tie this together with something called chakra tuning, what's your take on that?
Well, not necessarily, because it teaches us a lot of stuff. It's sort of like the work being done in the field of biofeedback, for instance. You get you know, an immediate read back. And that can teach you a lot. But again, until the consciousness changes, the form's not going to change, because the form follows consciousness always. The consciousness has made this form. Who we really are is not our physical bodies, nor our emotions, nor even our thoughts and mind. We have created these vehicles of expression to express ourselves in certain frequencies of matter. A good example on a much lower level would be, let's say an individual has a life crisis, let's say a bout with cancer. Now, one person can simply go and have physical surgery and have the tumor removed, but they change nothing in their consciousness or their lifestyle, and a few years down the road, the cancer reasserts itself. Other people will take that crisis as an opportunity to make vast changes in the way they live their lives. And so for them, the healing is not just the removal of the outer result of a misrelationship. They're actually working on the misrelationship that created the problem in the first place. Mm. We can learn a lot from these outer manipulations, because it's teaching us about how the energy body works. But in terms of true spiritual development, again, you only take with you what you build within your own consciousness.
Absolutely. And again, in regards to chakra tuning, do you think that it can work for a while? And again, much in the similar tradition as biofeedback, it can help to get you in tuned, maybe temporarily, but that's enough to get you familiar to, or even get the body familiar to the particular state that you preferably want to be in. What do you think?
I think that's very, very well put, because it does exactly that. It gets us familiar with a particular quality or frequency that we didn't know we could produce. And so, you know, I'm sure many of you listeners have heard the phrase, energy follows thought. Mm. Well, there's two more parts to that. Energy follows thought is number one. Force follows attention is number two. And recognition produces relationship is number three. So by recognizing something, we produce a relationship with it, and we enter into a dance with it, and we can begin to work with it.
Mm. And in regards to relaxation techniques, things like that, I guess you've been, this is some of the things that you've been, I guess, studying as well then and teaching about. What do you think are some of the, if you can give some hints or points or suggestions, the audience, for people listening, what would that be, and how would you suggest that people go about getting relaxed? Because again, there's actually, that can be very tricky these days. You know, there's hypertension, time is not enough as it is, and there's, it's just difficult to be in a state where you actually are completely relaxed. What has worked for you, for instance? What do you think are some of these techniques that can help you get into that state?
Well, I think the best way to answer you is give you a quick overview of what internal techniques actually are, because there's a lot out on the market that's called meditation that really isn't meditation. So let me give you a quick glossary here.
Yeah.
There are several different categories of techniques. For instance, the word dance can be a lot of different things, you know. Classical ballet requires a much different kind of discipline and level of commitment than just dancing with your friends at a club on Saturday night.
That's right.
Celtic step dancing produces a different type of body look than, say, Middle Eastern dancing. So these kinds of internal techniques are often all lumped under the umbrella of meditation. But let's sort that out a little bit. The most common techniques that you'll find out on the marketplace are relaxation techniques. And we don't really need to talk about them, because they are exactly what they describe. It's a way to relax your physical body. Now, they do really good things. They lower your blood pressure. They alleviate the symptoms of stress. And anybody can do them. But their effect is primarily on the physical body. Now, in a relaxed state, you are receptive to your more creative side. You know, in terms of brainwaves, for adults, your waking brain wave is primarily beta. And the only time we relax into alpha is right when we slip off into sleep or when we do some particular kind of technique. Most of the techniques that are out on the market produce an alpha wave, which is great. However, after about 3 years of doing a technique that produces primarily an alpha brainwave, you tend to get very spacey, and you tend to not be able to use your will very well. And you become, you know, very balanced and relaxed, but you can't really do a lot in the world. Mm. And so you really need, after about, you know, 3 years or so, and it differs with different individuals, you really need to move on to more advanced types of techniques. It's interesting that young children, their natural waking brainwave is alpha, which is why they're often so psychic and they can see things that adults can't. And they make the switch as they get older into that adult sort of beta mode. But basically, relaxation techniques do just that. They have a lot of really great benefits. There's lots of techniques out there. Some involve, you know, relaxation response by Dr. Benson was very popular in the 60s. Some involve music, you know, all kinds of different accoutrements. Mm-hmm. The next big category of techniques are visualization techniques. And these are being explored now by everybody from sports athletes to, you know, the cancer clinics that are using visualization to augment whatever cancer treatment people are undergoing. And visualization, again, is exactly what the name implies. It is visualizing, making pictures in your head. Now, it doesn't really matter whether you are a tennis player visualizing winning the game or visualizing spiritual energies moving out from your centers. It's still picture making. Mm. Just as relaxation focuses primarily on the physical body, the effects of visualization include all the good stuff from the earlier category, but now add a certain amount of emotional refinement and control. And visualization techniques are not just making pictures in your head, but bringing in all the senses. For instance, if you can imagine clearly enough a rabid dog in front of you, you can trigger your own fight or flight mechanism. Mm. So people wonder if, you know, pictures that they make in their head can have any effect whatsoever on the physical body. Just give them the example of sexual fantasy. That's something everybody knows about. Mm. So certainly pictures that we make in our head work. Now, the interesting thing is why they work. Remember that we don't perceive the world through our senses. We perceive the world through our brain. Our brain simply receives information from the senses, and it's the brain that sorts it out. The brain doesn't really care if something's really happening out there in the world. If you make a good enough picture of it, the brain will act on it as if it were there. And so visualization has to do with a certain level of expertise. Now, you move on from visualization into the area of concentration. And concentration is a training for the mind. And these three steps, the physical, the emotional, and the mental, are the three steps into the temple of initiation, really, that we see in so many different world systems. Concentration is not something you'll find a lot about out in the marketplace because it's boring and it's hard and people don't want to do it. Mm. It's really fun to sit and make pictures in your head and talk to your guides or masters or, you know, whatever. But to sit and learn how to be internally quiet, to shut up inside, to stop talking to yourself so that you can listen to something more subtle. This is very difficult. Also, adults are used to doing things well. And if they try something and they don't do it well, after the first couple of tries, they give up and say, oh, well, I'm really much more spiritually advanced. I don't really need to do those techniques. Hmm. When actually, that's really where they need to be. Now, how to do a concentration technique? In the East, they would generally take something like a flower or a rock or a natural object. In the West, they would choose something perhaps like a Pythagorean theorem. You know, those theorems that you studied in high school and college are really Western mandalas, and they at one time had a great deal of meaning. So in Western systems, you would choose something like a geometric figure. And using something of visualization, using something of relaxation, the way to do a concentration technique is you picture an object in front of your forehead in that particular area, and you just hold the picture. For instance, if you've chosen a flower, you're not thinking of the great cosmic significance of that flower. You're not thinking of the meaning of its color. You're not talking to yourself about it at all. You simply hold the picture and just hold it. You just stay silent with it. Now, you can only do that for about 3 seconds. And then you'll say, oh, I'm doing it. Well, you've just blown it because you've talked to yourself. So you have to bring your concentration back to that particular object. And it's a training of the brain. It's a training of the lower mind to be still, to be quiet, and not be asleep, to be absolutely, totally awake, internally active, and yet like the surface of a glassy pool of water, absolutely calm, because only calm water can reflect the sunlight. And when you have some ability in concentration, then you're ready to move on to real meditation. And real meditation is more than just relaxation, just visualization, or even concentration. Real meditation has to do with the internal work, which is spiritual alchemy.
And do you, Georgia, do these things in a particular step, as you mentioned them, and just carry on? This is like a ladder that you ascend or descend, however we want to put it, or do you like stop and take breaks in between, or how do you do it?
Do you mean myself, my own practices, or
sure.
Or in the classes?
Well, sure, we can talk about both, but what do you do?
Well, the kinds of internal techniques that are part of my personal practice are not in these particular categories. They're under the category of real meditation, which we could talk about a little if you like.
Yeah, sure. But in regards to these different, the three steps that you talk about, how to get kind of, in one sense, control over yourself, your emotional center, your body, and then also your brain or the thought process. Is this something that you recommend people to do in one step, if you know what I mean, but one at a time, and trying to just get control over these different centers and calm them down? Is that what you suggest?
Well, it depends on the person. Often people that seek the greater mysteries go through a period that I like to call spiritual smorgasbording, you know.
Hmm.
You have to know what's out there before you find something that works for you, because there's no one technique that works for everybody.
Sure.
You have to find the thing that works for you. And what works for you at one stage of your growth may not work for you later on. You progress. And so in terms of the lesser mysteries, there was training provided in the physical realm. There was training provided in the emotional realm, learning how to change negative emotions into positive ones without suppressing the emotional nature. Mm. There was training in concentration and mental disciplines. And then you had to integrate these three parts of yourself into one working unit. And that's really the function of the center in front of the forehead. It's the integration of the three horses pulling the chariot. Sometimes what your physical body wants and what your emotions want and what your mind wants are three completely different things. You've got to get them all pulling together so that you can go somewhere. And so once you have this integrated, fairly well-trained personality, which includes the mind, then it can be of real use to the soul. because it doesn't matter how all-wise and wonderful the soul is, it can't work through a dull, stupid, and unresponsive personality. So the personality has to be integrated and trained to be not the prison of the soul, but the trusted servant of the soul, the hands and feet of the soul. And so once you've gotten the techniques and the internal work, really, of the integration and training of the personality, now you can begin to move into the higher techniques of real meditation, spiritual alchemy, all of that kind of stuff.
Tell us a little bit more about spiritual alchemy. I mean, people will be who are listening. We've talked about the general terms in regards to alchemy, some of the traditions. But tell us what your definition of spiritual alchemy is.
Well, spiritual alchemy, of course, is really the great work. Even in medieval times, it was known that the real work of the alchemist was within the alchemist himself, that it wasn't outwardly making lead into gold. It had to do with the refining of one's own inner nature and the birth of one as a spiritual being in this particular time and place. The bringing together or the divine marriage of your higher self with your worldly self. And this divine marriage has been talked about in so many different traditions. One of the first functions of real meditation is to engineer this divine marriage or close the gap between what's called the overshadowing spiritual soul or your higher self, existing above form as we know it, and your focus of consciousness in this time and place within the brain, to bring these two parts of yourself together into a one integrated unit. And this means setting up communication lines with that higher self. And it's a two-way communication. It's not just being receptive to the higher self. It's an interaction. And as that interaction ensues, it brings these parts together. Now, earlier in the first segment, we were talking about mythology and how in Western systems, the chakras were often shown as mythological animals. Having already said that spiritual growth has to work from subtle to dense, it has to work from inside to the outside. Let me just give you an example of one of the outside effects at the tail end of this process. In Western systems, in looking at mythological stories, the first chakra or the center at the base of the tail, the root center or the kundalini center, as some are called, the symbol for this was the dragon or the serpent. And we think of the serpent in the tree in the Garden of Eden, or we think of the mythology about dragons guarding treasure. And dragons, you know, at first are very destructive. They fly through medieval villages setting roofs ablaze, don't they?
Yes.
But later, they become that Chinese dragon of wisdom. So the first chakra, the symbols in the West are often dragons or serpent beings. The next center up relating to the gender and sexedness. In the West, some of the common symbols were the centaur or the satyr, the half horse, half man, half animal nature, half human, or half goat, half human. In children, it's the prepubescent sacral center, the fawn, F-A-U-N. The solar plexus is the next one up, and it is the main seat of the emotions. This is the center out of which the mass of humanity still functions. It is called, in Eastern tradition, the home of the pairs of opposites, because any energy worked through this center gets split in its manifestation. And so we have religion supposedly based on love, ready to slaughter each other.
That's right.
Water is the age-old symbol of the emotions. In the Old Testament, it's part the Red Sea, get through as quick as you can before it closes over on top of you. In the New Testament is, you know, you calm the waters, you walk on top of the waters. So water symbols are appropriate to this. The kraken in Greek mythology, or sea serpents, or those lake nymphs that would lure knights to their death. All those manners of water symbols. The next chakra up is the heart center, the lion. This is the king of beasts. The king of the center is below the head. It's the king not because it's the strongest or the smartest, but because it's golden and it has a radiatory mane. It's like the sun within the body. And this is where the spiritual path begins. And this is why many mystery systems revere the sun at one outward level. So the lion is a sun symbol. The symbol of the throat is the bull. Astrologically, in mundane astrology, this is Taurus, actually. But from an esoteric standpoint, this is where the creative word of God goes forth. In Gothic cathedrals, you often saw bulls carved on pulpits. And of course, in ancient tradition, you have the winged bull of the Babylonians, for instance. And of course, you know, garbage from the throat center is still called bullshit, isn't it?
That's right. Good one.
The great presidents of the Pope are papal bulls, right? So the bull is the symbol of the throat center. The symbol for the center in front of the forehead in Western tradition, one of the symbols, there's several. One of them is a rooster because it is the first bird to herald the light of day. And actually, in the bones of the face, there is a little protuberance of bone right there called the Christogalli, which means coxcomb. And so you see the rooster figuring in Gnostic tradition. In Greek tradition, this center is symbolized by the Pegasus. It's white, it's purified, it's the animal nature given wings. And you see the Pegasus involved in all kinds of mythological stories. The head center or crown chakra, its primary symbol is the unicorn because it's a Christ symbol. And the story about the unicorn is that the unicorn's horn was magical and it was healing. And the unicorn lived in a forest where there was a stream that ran through the forest, and the stream was poison. And when the unicorn came and dipped his head in the water to drink, his horn touched the water and purified the stream for all of the other beasts to drink. Now, earlier we were talking about this interplay between the head center and the ajna center. The one above the physical head, the one in front of the forehead. We talked about their physical touchdown points as being the pineal and pituitary glands. Well, in the center of the brain, there is a space called the third ventricle. And the third ventricle is a very narrow little space or opening. And this is Plato's cave. This is Merlin's cave. This is the room at the top of the stairs for Rosicrucians, where the marriage feast takes place. And in this third ventricle live the pituitary and the pineal gland. Now, the cerebrospinal fluid, which is produced mostly in the lateral ventricles of the brain, pools into this third ventricle. When you have done enough internal disciplines and training on subtle levels to activate both the head or crown chakra and the chakra in front of the forehead, the tail end of this process is these activated centers activate the glands in a new way. And the glands release subtle alchemical essences, if you like, into this cerebrospinal fluid in the center of the head. That spinal fluid then moves down the spinal cord, and the waters are changed for all of the other beast chakras, the beast centers, to drink from. And all of the lower centers are changed because of the alchemy in the head. It's transmitted from the head to the rest of the body. So that's just a physical example of the tail end of some of this alchemy that goes on as you begin to practice and do internal disciplines. When the Christians say, saved by the blood of the Christ, that's absolutely literal, because when the Christ consciousness is born within the head, you know, the child of God is born within the heart, but the adult son is born within the head. And when that consciousness is born within the head, it produces profound changes on every level of the persona. And so that eventually, we have that divine marriage, that transfiguration, that illumination that affects a change in mind, in emotions, and all the way down to the physical body, blood, and nervous system.
That's really, really interesting. And I want to ask you about the idea that in terms of these, the mythological stories represented in many cases by these animals or in some cases deities, do you think that this knowledge was absolutely known in that sense about the body, or has this, for some other reason, crept into human consciousness as a way of almost the intelligence of the body, that the body has been trying to tell us in a way of what is going on in real sense? Or do you think that this knowledge has been known for by previous, I guess, cultures or even civilizations in that term?
Well, certainly it was known by previous civilizations because it was at the heart of the mystery traditions. But even on a subconscious level, the outward symbols do have effects in us. You know, when you learn to paint and you learn to do portraiture, one of the first things you have to learn is how not to paint yourself. All artists put their own characteristics into their portraits on an unconscious level because all of our creations carry something of our frequency, our quality. And so when we create a civilization or we create an outer world en masse, within that are going to be symbols of where our consciousness is. The outer life and affairs is a reflection of our inner world. And that's why you can have somebody want to change their life, and so they move to a different country and they take a different name. But, you know, they take them with them. So pretty soon they're attracting the same kinds of friends, the same kinds of situations, because their consciousness is drawing from the environment and maneuvering the environment and shaping the environment to give them an outward picture of their own state of being.
Yes.
So collectively, we do this as civilizations. And so there's lots of outer symbols that we have that have a great deal of meaning that maybe people don't get on a conscious basis, but they get it somewhere. And then slowly they progress to a point where now they get it consciously. You know, progression on the path is always more conscious, never less conscious.
That's very, 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 very good. Well said. And I think that it's interesting that you bring up this aspect of how the external world in one sense reflect what we, the lessons, if you will, or even the problems that we need to overcome or face or realize. Do you think that this is across the board for all people? And I guess when you say that this is true for nations as well or a certain type of people or a city, do you think that this works in a larger context beyond the individual as well?
Oh, absolutely. You're right on there. You know, it's the same pattern, isn't it? I mean, we're finding that creation is holographic. It's fractal. We see the same pattern repeated to the small as to the large. You know, the old medieval saying, as above, so below.
Yes.
Look at that saying for a moment. It doesn't say as above, so here. It says as above, so below. That implies a middle. And the middle is where we stand, where our consciousness is. And our job is to bring heaven to earth, to reach up into that area of divinity, to sense that divine harmony and pattern, and then to reproduce it outwardly. We are the creative hands and feet of God. Right now, we are imperfectly creating. Instead of creating God's plan on earth, we're creating our own separative plan on earth. This is true of individuals. It's true of groups. It's true of nations. And in fact, an esoteric study of history is also part of mystery tradition. It's very interesting to see the development of nations as living creatures that have an infancy, an adolescence, a maturity, a decline, and death. All civilizations are cyclic. And to see the back and forth interplay of nations as a sort of karmic dance, and to see the karmic factors that are in play, and why does one nation draw a particular opponent or a particular ally. And to see it from an esoteric level is absolutely fascinating.
Do you think that where and also when people are born plays into this as well, that this happens for a specific reason? I guess in one sense, I would suspect that you don't think that anything that happens in the universe is a fluke, right?
Right. There is nothing in the universe that is without meaning. Meaning is everywhere. We may not recognize it, but that doesn't mean that it isn't there. We can look into the most horrific of situations, the most negative of appearances, and see that within the very heart of that situation is some quality of soul or consciousness trying to work its way out. And it'll keep coming around until we get the lesson and make the adjustment. You know, when something first comes around, it sort of whispers to us and we ignore it, and then it comes around a little stronger and a little stronger until finally we have to deal with it because it's a life-altering crisis. We always have the opportunity of dealing with it when it's sort of benign, but we rarely choose that as a species. We always wait until our back's against the wall to make changes. And as a planet, that's where we are today, aren't we?
Absolutely. And do you think it's, how should I put it? Do you think it's difficult for people to kind of identify what it is that they need to change if they're given a specific message in one way over and over, or stronger and stronger, as you said? Do you think it's difficult for many people to realize what that specific change is, or do you think that they subconsciously on one level actually know precisely what they need to do, so to speak?
I think it's both. I think on a subconscious level, they know exactly what it is because they've engineered it to bring something to their conscious attention. On the level of their conscious brain awareness, it may take a few times before they recognize it or even want to get it. You know, most people try to run away from it or avoid it, and after a while, that doesn't work, and then they have to deal with it.
What do you think will happen if people do run away or try to avoid it? Do you think that could lead to health issues or other kinds of trauma in our lives? Or what do you think the outcome of that will be?
Oh, it could be anything. Certainly the things that you just mentioned. You know, it can work out in our physical body, but it can also work out as some, you know, emotional crisis or even mental identity crisis. It just depends on the makeup of the individual. But the idea is to, you know, in all of this training of the personality and integrating of the personality to become a fit instrument, it's working through these very issues. It's learning how to recognize them and how to resolve them rather than simply avoid them or run away from them, which we can't really do anyway.
A good point. How about other disciplines? Like, for instance, if we talk a little bit about either astrology or things like the Kabbalah, or do you see on one level that all these different techniques and tools, if you will, are connected in some way, or do you differ between them and use them for different purposes or something like that?
Well, they're all useful. I mean, they're all out picturing different ways of human approach. Each one's a little different. Each one is a different tone or color. Each one emphasizes perhaps different things, but they're all tools, and that's just what they are. They're tools, and the individual should study or pick up that which speaks to them, that which resonates with them. Eventually, though, you get to the place where you don't need any tools. But until you get to that place, all the tools are useful.
Yeah. And in regards to the Kabbalah, is this something that you've been studying as well?
It's certainly one of the systems. I have a 5-year course on the Kabbalah, which is a course of internal work, not just theory. But you could use any system. You could use the Arthurian system. You could use, some of the things that are taught in Rosicrucianism. I mean, it really doesn't matter once you understand that it's the same story and path.
These different techniques, they seem to sprung up from different regions at different times, but yet they're telling the same message. And I just find that as an overall principle, very, very interesting. And what's your take on that? again, do we tie this back to the idea that everything around us is giving us the same message all the time? So it doesn't matter at what time period we're talking about or where on the planet people have been born, because again, we have different systems will come to us in some way that will tell us about how to progress in regards to consciousness. Or what do you think? Why do you think these different systems have popped up on different locations on the earth and during different times, but saying the same thing?
Well, one of the things that we know about matter or the body of God is that it loves diversity. You know, it's matter's job to be diverse. And part of the quest is to learn how to produce that oneness of consciousness, to be with the one life, to be with the soul of humanity, and at the same time embrace the diversity of form. And with that diversity of form, you have many outpicturings of the different mystery traditions. And although they all say the same thing, different cultures, different systems emphasize slightly different points, as we were just talking about. The thing to remember, though, is when you take any system, whether it be the Arthurian system, the Kabbalistic system, the Rosicrucian system, the Masonic system, whatever it is, there are beginning levels and there are deeper levels. So someone studying the Kabbalah could study it at many different levels. And so, again, you have to really listen to your own intuition. I know that sounds very trite, but within every human being is sort of a built-in head and heart mechanism. And it has to resonate with that, you know? A technique or a system might be great for your friend, but if it doesn't resonate with you, there's a reason for it. And you need to learn to pay attention to your own intuition and also to give yourself the freedom to realize that they are only tools, and you can pick one up and learn from it, and it'll build in certain things, and then you can let it go. You know, there's no personal loyalty to a particular system or teacher. Any true teacher is not interested in collecting devotees. A true teacher is going to teach you how to stand on your own two spiritual feet and to follow your own quest,
yes,
which might be different from that of the teacher even.
Very good point. And when you're talking about the personal things that one can use and for intuition and so forth, or that this needs to be filtered through the intuition filter, if you know what I mean. How about synchronicity, for instance? This is, again, going back to Carl Jung a little bit, I guess, but for me, this is very much a personal tool as well, where you see hints, so to speak, given to you at certain points in time. Is this something that you've been looking into as well?
Well, you know, the whole idea of synchronicity was made popular in recent times with a couple of books that were published some years ago. And certainly synchronicity is one of the first, as you say, hints that things are starting to pull into alignment. But those are only hints. You have to, of course, now do something with what you see.
Yes.
And
yes,
what people have to understand is no teacher's going to give it to you. No book's going to give it to you. No system is going to give it to you. And if they say they will, a red flag should go up. You know, there's no way around doing your own inner road work. The whole idea of the path is to achieve mastery or adeptship. But adept at what? You know, mastery of what? Mastery of your own share of planetary matter, which exists physically, emotionally, and mentally. Adeptship is the mastering of one's own matter so that it becomes that beautiful vehicle through which the soul can work. And this means doing your own inner road work. Now, there's lots of tools out there. There's lots of information. Use all of it. Pick what you need. Pick what you resonate with. And trust that, you know, your own spiritual evolution has gotten you this far. It's not going to quit on you now. And you'll find the next thing. If you're seriously seeking, you are, in a sense, that Grail Knight, asking the right question. Keep asking that question because it produces a relationship with the answer, which is your next piece, your next tool, your next step. your next experience, whatever that experience comes as in terms of its form nature.
Very good advice, Georgia. By the way, do you have any upcoming talks or events or anything like this that you'll be doing soon?
Not at the moment. I am focused on the classes that I have currently. I have physical classes, but I also have a lot of online classes, as we talked about before, and I'm getting ready to start several new ones. So right now, that's at the forefront of my attention.
Where can people go in order to find out more about these events on your website?
Well, any one of the sections will route you eventually. The Lambert's Lookout section, which is the second section, has the list of upcoming classes. And if you want to find out how the classes actually work, that's in the first section. But what I've got going currently will be in the second section. And they can email me from any section.
Okay, wonderful. And it's four sections, by the way. But again, I'm going to mention the website here, lambertslodge.com. Is there anything else, Georgia, that you'd like to mention before we begin to wrap things up here for this time?
I just want to say thank you for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to speak to your audience, which I'm assuming is mostly European. As I said, I've lived in Europe at various times in my life, and I've taught a lot in England, and would very much like to live there one of these days again. So hello to a whole new audience out there.
Absolutely. Hopefully we can bring some European audience to you as well. I want to mention also again here the great work, the DVD that Georgia is featured in together with many other teachers and so forth. And some of them we had on this program, like Art Rosengarten, Lon Milo Duquette, and John Anthony West, to mention just a few. You can head on over to magicalegypt.com in case you want to take a look at that as well. A really, really good and well-produced DVD series by Chance Gardner and Vanessa McNeil. So with that, thank you very much again, Georgia, for coming on the program. We really enjoyed it and hope we can do it again soon and go into a bit more things that we didn't have time to talk about today.
I am at your service.
Thank you for listening to our program with Georgia Lambert. My name is Henrik, and my thanks to Fredrik behind the controls. We will be back soon with more radio on interesting and important subjects. So stay well, in sync, and
it began in Africa. Ga, 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 ga.